Sophia Stone è professore assistente alla Lynn
University
online.
Lynn.
Grazie. A Boca Raton, Florida. Ha avuto il suo dottorato in filosofia con una specializzazione in filosofia e letteratura nel 2014. La sua dissertazione è chiamata come titolo La metafisica platonica dell'anima, ed ha scritto, che ha scritto sotto la direzione della mia amica Patricia Cart, con nell'ambito della filosofia greca. Le sue ricerche includono l'etica, la filosofia, la letteratura. Il suo progetto corrente attuale include diversi aspetti dell'interpretazione delle interpretazioni del Fedone platonico, e sta anche lavorando come cartoonist nel realizzare i dialoghi socratici in un nuovo formato grafico. Prego, 20 minuti di relazione e 10 minuti di domande. Prego.
Thank you. It's an honor to be here, a privilege, and I want to thank you all for coming. We tend to think that the proofs for the immortality of the soul fail because of the last argument. I think this is because of a misunderstanding of being in the Phaedo. In this paper, after I analyze the existence of the two classes of objects and argue for a third, I use the concept of being from Parmenides for the last argument. If we understand being as in Parmenides' work, then we can avoid certain errors. For example, if we understand being as monoideis on autokathauto, then tupur, heitrias, and heitsuke each cannot be an autos to eidos, but a combination of many objects. With my analysis, I hope to show that the last argument in the Phaedo to be valid, and I'm on page 973 if you want to follow along. Soul as a form or particular doesn't work for the final proof. If soul is a form, then the final proof fails and fallacious blunders. If soul is a particular, then not only does Socrates contradict what he said earlier about particulars in the affinity argument, it remains unclear whether, even if soul were immortal, how much of that soul can be said to be the soul of Socrates, since it is his soul that his friends are most concerned. Socrates is in good cheer up until the time he drinks the hemlock, but does his happiness rest on bad arguments? Following the work of Curd and Naamas, I argue here for a Parmenidean account of being for Plato's forms in the Phaedo. That is, for the view that forms are completely and wholly what they are, while the objects that acquire form characteristics have those characteristics attributively, relationally, accidentally, and temporarily. First, I focus on the claims made in the affinity argument. Then I utilize this reading in my analysis of the final proof for the immortality of the soul. In my analysis, where others have assumed the role for forms, I argue for form characteristics, particulars, or mathematical intermediates. This move away from the traditional interpretations will come out especially in the final proof, when Socrates talks about objects such as snow, fire, three, and soul. Along with Phaedo, I argue that the final proof in the Phaedo is formally correct, that is, Plato has neither drawn false inferences nor simply begged the question, but departing from Phaedo, I conclude that soul must be an intermediate object. So the language Plato uses in the Phaedo, 78d1-7, specifies what a form is and limits what forms can be. He adopts the Parmenidean account of being in his description of the forms in the Phaedo, an account that he returns to in the Symposium at 211a1-b9. This conception of being implies that a form to'on is, monoideis is a single form, that is, it shares in no other forms, kathauto is itself by itself, is not relational or dependent on anything else, asynthenton is incomposite, and aikatatauta is unvarying and constant. me potem tabellaim is never changing. In the Phaedo, forms are what they are completely. While there are characteristics that describe forms as such, as form is what it is by being a single characteristic that characterizes what it is, the form beauty is beautiful. At 78d5, forms are described as monoides on autocadalto, being a single form itself by itself. It has already been pointed out by Hackforth that monoides, quote, has the same force as panhomoion, which Parmenides asserts of his henhon, which he takes as the denial of internal difference or distinction of unlike parts. This Eleatic notion of being includes that of immutability. Solmsen points out that auto ho esten itself, which is, we find in the Phaedo, can be recognized as the formula which secures for each of Plato's forms the true Parmenidean esten. So what is the meaning of true Parmenidean esten? In Parmenides' Fragments, lines B8:43-45, the goddess says, since now its limit is ultimate, being is completed from every viewpoint, like the expanse of a spherical ball and equally poised in every direction from its center. For it must not be either at all greater, at all smaller in one regard than another. The way the goddess describes being is quite telling. The imagery is representative of how being and its characteristics should be comprehended. It is not meant as a literal description. The Parmenidean being is not round like a ball, nor is it shaped like a sphere, for round and shape imply a material object. Rather, like the expanse of a spherical object, being is the same all around. Its characteristic never changes, nor matter the perspective, no matter the time or place. Like the expanse of a Parmenidean sphere that is the same in every direction, forms exclude degree, qualification, and relation. Understood this way, being is atemporal, aspatial, non-aspectival, and without parts. Forms are what they are by themselves, needing nothing else. So in the Phaedo, not only do forms exclude their opposites, arguably, they also exclude other forms tout court. Which means, in the Phaedo at least, forms cannot participate in other forms. So the objects that play a crucial role in the final proof, fire, snow, three, and soul, are not forms since a characteristic of another form occupies them, hotness, coldness, oddness, and aliveness. The reading of Phaedo I am arguing for also rejects the notion that there is a form for every particular. Instead, I hold that a particular is what it is by sharing in many forms. Thus, although Sarkadi's soul is a particular as an embodied soul, it would not follow that there was a form soul. Rather, his soul participates in several more basic forms. If the claims about forms and particulars in the affinity proof are meant to clarify and also limit what the objects are in the final proof, let's turn to the final proof. Socrates promises his friends at 100b59 that if they grant him the hypothesis that there is something as beauty itself by itself, autokathauto, good and tall and all the rest, to alapanta, that he hopes to show from these idea that to discover that the soul is immortal. So the first part of his proof is going to rely upon forms themselves by themselves. Socrates later makes this clear, although his explanation is still a bit wanting, at 100d4, that nothing else makes it beautiful other than that beautiful, either being present in or communion with, or in whatever and however it comes to be beautiful. At 100d8, 7, all the beautiful things come to be beautiful by the beautiful. The nature of what we now call participation here is ambiguous. Later, Socrates will give us examples to clarify a bit what he means. Notice, though, that it seems if we stick to just these surefire aetia, that if we are asking for why soul is immortal, it seems at first that the answer must include a form, and many have taken this step. However, if we look at the examples, it is clear that this first hypothesis is meant to show the connection between particulars and forms and how particulars acquire their form characteristics. Socrates repeats this hypothesis at 100e23 and applies the hypothesis, which is now acting like a principle, to large things, small things, and so on. And after applying the hypothesis to particular things, he applies it to numbers. I quote, "And you would loudly exclaim that you do not know any other way how each thing can come to be other than it having a share of the particular being from each of which it shares. And in these such things, you wouldn't have any other idea of coming to be two rather than the sharing of duality. And necessarily, the things about to become two will come to be two by sharing. And that which is one would be by unity. And you would be glad to dismiss subtractions and additions and all other sophisticated answers, allowing those more wisely than you to answer." I take Socrates to be claiming here that whatever characteristics something other than a form has, it has that characteristic by its sharing or participation in a form. Later, Socrates will call this aetion the safe and ignorant one. Notice that he is not here talking about how substances come to be. Rather, Socrates is talking about how anything, whether something is one, something is beautiful, or something is tall, comes to have that characteristic, and so by having it, is that characteristic. As has been said before by Hackforth, beauty itself is not the cause of a beautiful thing, but of a thing's being beautiful. So we're talking about the being beautiful here. When understood in this way, other interpretations on offer can be excluded. For example, the interpretation by Prince that, quote, "everything that comes to be, both substances and properties, does so by sharing in a form," should be excluded. I tend to shy away from terminology of substances and their properties, for these are Aristotle's terms. There is no underlying subject, a hypokeimenon, in Plato's ontology. Instead, I think of particulars having many characteristics, and so participate in many forms. And while there may be a single form that is responsible for particulars coming to being and passing away, the form life, other forms are involved for a particular thing being that thing. Thus, there is not a form fire, which is the aetion for a particular fire, nor is there a form soul, which is the aetion for an individual soul. Rather, there's a form hot that is the aetion for an individual fire to be hot, and a form life that is the aetion for an individual soul to be alive. And there is a form justice that is the aetion for an individual soul to be just. In the Phaedo, at least, Socrates does not posit a form for every particular. Instead, he posits a form for certain characteristics that characterize what a particular is. Thus, we can point out the soul of Socrates from other souls in virtue of the many form characteristics it has. There are some characteristics that particulars have accidentally, such as Simmias being tall, and some characteristics that particulars have necessarily, such as fire being hot, snow being cold. Characteristics of forms behave in a similar manner when particulars have them. That is, they exclude the opposite form characteristic. For although Simmias is said to be both short and tall, a particular does not hold the opposite characteristics at the same time. Thus, the first axiom Socrates gives is at 102d6 and following. He says, "It appears to me that not only the tall itself is never willing to be tall and short at the same time, but also the tall in us is never willing to admit the short, nor be overcome. But each of two things can happen. Either it flees and withdraws whenever the opposite, the short, approaches it, or it is destroyed by the approach of the short. But it does not wish to remain and accept shortness and be other than it was." While the characteristics of forms and forms themselves both exclude their opposites, the grounds for the exclusion differs. We learn from the affinity argument that it is the nature of forms to always remain as they are. Forms never change. So the form large will never be large and small, and this is because a form doesn't suffer a compression of opposites. That is, a form has a single characterizing characteristic that makes that form the kind of form that it is, and this characterizing characteristic never changes. Nor would a form acquire other characteristics than it already has, and this is all because forms do not change. In contrast, what we call particulars always change. They will eventually lose every characteristic. It is also part of their nature that they suffer a compression of opposites. Either in time or in place or from this perspective or that, a particular will be both large and small. Simmias is both tall and small, though not at the same time and in the same respect, and this is what the first axiom was meant to clarify. The first axiom, which was at 102d6 through e3, 3 applies to the accidental characteristics of objects. Simius will remain simius, and upon the approach of an opposite characteristic, it is the shortness or tallness in him that withdraws or is destroyed. The second axiom at 103d 5 through 8 applies to necessary characteristics of objects, and what happens to the objects when the opposite to the necessary characteristic approaches. Socrates gives these examples of snow and fire. Snow is something cold, necessarily, and fire is something hot, necessarily. When the hot, to thermon, approaches snow, or the cold, to supron, approaches fire, the fire or the snow will either make way for it and escape or be destroyed. What snow and fire cannot do is remain with the opposite to their necessary characteristic and still be snow and fire. It is worth saying here that topsukon and topteron are not the forms themselves. Forms do not change or move, so they cannot approach anything. They are objects that have characteristics of the forms, the characteristics that these particulars happen to have necessarily. And Socrates makes clearly exactly this point at 103e 2 through 6. And I put this in a footnote because I had to shorten the paper. He then applies the second axiom to numbers. The change from particulars to numbers is significant for the following reasons. Particulars always change, and at some point in time they will be destroyed, apolesai. Numbers always remain the same and cannot be destroyed. We experience particulars sensorially. It is through the senses, particulars are first comprehended. In contrast, we intuit numbers through the mind's eye, through the intellect. In a way, numbers belong to that invisible realm, the same realm as the forms. Their particular instantiation in bodies, however, makes them present and known in the visible realm. In this way, number mediates the same two realms as the soul, the visible and the invisible. We don't ever see the number 3, we see its instantiation in 3 objects. It is just like the soul. We don't ever see the soul, we just witness its instantiation in a living body. So the move from particulars having accidental and necessary characteristics to numbers secures for Socrates the ground by which he will rest his argument for the immortality of the soul. And so since I am almost out of time, I'm going to skip to page 980. Problems with soul as a form or an immanent form. So from passages 104d 1 through 7 and 105d 3 through 5, has been argued by Hackforth and more recently by Prince that the subject of karaske is a form or an immanent form occupying a body. For Hackforth, soul must be a form until passage 106e, and for Prince, soul must be a form until passage 105c. In both readings, the ontological status of soul changes from a form of soul to a particular soul. O'Brien similarly sees a shift from the form which brings an opposite to the particular soul which brings life to the body. He says that it would probably be wrong to exclude either interpretation in favor of the other. As was pointed out by Keith, treating soul like a form entails that Socrates has proved the absurd conclusion that the ensouled body is immortal. And I'll skip what Keith says here. Plato would not have made the blunder that it is that which the soul occupies is as mortal. As was pointed out by Schiller, Keith makes this claim because he assumes a parallel reading from 104d to 105d. Another answer is available to us, bringing in the account from the affinity proof. It is the nature of particulars that they always change. Eventually, they would lose every characteristic they have. The ensouled body, as a particular, can never be immortal. For soul is never, i.e., always in a body. Rather, soul always brings life to a body. This is the force of the second and third axioms. Soul always has the character of being alive whenever it exists. And whenever soul exists in a body, it brings that characteristic to the body, making that body a living thing. I'm going to skip a little here. The soul does not occupy the body in the sense in which trias occupies tria. This is Archer Hinn's note. The triad is the cause why the 3 are 3. The soul is not the cause why body is body, but the cause why it is alive. However, unlike Schiller and Archer Hinn, we need not take soul to be a particular. If soul is the aetion for a body being alive, because the soul always carries with it life, then this is parallel to three being the aetion for three objects being odd, because three always carries with it the unit. The objects Socrates is talking about here are intermediates, those unaccounted objects from the affinity argument that always have a characterizing form characteristic along with other characteristics that make them what they are. With their characterizing characteristic and their intermediate status, they are, at one time, that which is occupied by a form characteristic, as well as that which is something that occupies a body. Being intermediates, they never lose their characterizing characteristic, but nor do they go out of existence, and this is what they share in common with forms. Hence the addition at 106d6. I think, said Socrates, that God and the form of life itself and any other thing that is, that if it is immortal, then we would all be in agreement that they can never be destroyed. As Dorothea Freda argued in her 1978 paper, Socrates has proven formally that the soul is immortal. Now, with the account of being that I've given here, we know just what kind of soul, object soul must be, an intermediate. And I didn't define an intermediate. How much time do I have left? Okay, that's it. Okay. I'll tell you. So if somebody wants to ask me what an intermediate is, I will gladly answer that question. Okay, so whereas a form is a single characterizing characteristic that never leaves, an intermediate always has a single characterizing characteristic, but it also may be the kind of object that it is that has other characteristics that it loses, right? So soul can change. It can become just or unjust depending on the actions of, say, a human being. But numbers also can suffer a compression of opposites in that 4 is larger than 3 and it's smaller than 5. So these are different than forms, but they are also different from particulars, but they share attributes, I guess, of each.
How much of Aristotle's testimony about the intermediates are you willing to accept then?
For numbers, and I'm only going to accept right now what he says in the Metaphysics A, 6, for the numbers. I think my reading for soul is definitely arguable. I don't know that we can find that in Aristotle, but I
but for numbers, you think you'll accept all?
I don't see why not, and I think that maybe Proclus might accept my idea of the intermediates for soul.
I like the paper a lot. I'm in broad agreement with a lot of things.
I guess I'm wondering about the claim that the intermediates don't have compresence of opposites.
No, they do.
Sorry, at the same time, I thought you were denying. So you have this on page 977.
Okay.
It appears to me that not only the tall itself is never willing to be tall and the short at the same time, but also the tall in us is never willing. And I thought your account was, correct me if I'm wrong, that that's at different times. At one time, the person is tall and another time they're short.
Right, but then we're talking about the embodied intermediates.
Okay,
right?
the
and
embodied.
And so when the intermediate becomes embodied, it's susceptible to this compression of opposites.
So I guess there were two things that I was wondering about here. So one, in the affinity argument, he says that the sensible things are practically never the same as other things or as themselves. So
mm-hmm.
There is no time at which, never, are they the same as themselves.
Okay.
And so the other thing that I was wondering about is just the nature of the example. It seems like you have a person who at the very same time is larger than one person and smaller than another.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not at different times. Now, you could say it's in different respects, but it's not clear that that's... being emphasized in the text in a way that you might think, say, the Republic suggests. So here I am, some people are taller than me, other people are shorter than me right now.
Mm-hmm.
And you might think that that's picking up what we're getting in the affinity argument,
mm-hmm.
that at the same, that they're never the same as themselves. So the large thing is at this moment not a large thing.
Okay, so perhaps maybe an emendation to my view was that rather than the conjunction of not relatable, etc., that maybe I should say the disjunction, right? So, and if a particular is never the same as itself, then it means that it's always changing. And so, whether you're looking at it from a relative point of view, or whether and of course, time is always changing. So these perspectives, I think, open it to this compression of opposites. I don't know if that answers your question.
Yeah,
so
I mean, if you're happy with the idea of something like Irwin's aspect change or something,
mm-hmm.
you know, so as long as we don't need change over time, then,
thanks a lot, Sophia. You know, I'm very sympathetic with the journal reading. I was just wondering. So you bring numbers and soul together as these kind of intermediates, and I just so two thoughts came to my mind. One, why don't we get actually any language of intermediate? I mean, in the Republic, we get the numbers being clearly on the side of the intelligible,
mm-hmm.
and we have later when Plato is willing to say, okay, I can't just go with being and becoming; I need something third, right? And in the intermediates, we have numbers being uncreated and the soul being created. So I was wondering how your story then picks that up. Whether the idea is okay. The numbers and soul are both intermediates, but the realm of intermediates can be pretty broad, and the ones like the numbers are closer to the forms, and the soul may be closer to that, but still it's its own realm.
Mm-hmm.
And when do you have anything where you think that Plato comes closer to making it actually explicit numbers?
Oh, well, certainly he doesn't make it explicit. But if you look at so the whole project began with trying to be as charitable as possible to Plato, and to think, well, if he thinks that the final proof works, was sufficiently proved, what could he possibly be thinking about soul? And he couldn't possibly be thinking that soul is a particular, and he couldn't possibly be thinking that soul is a form, and so what other option do I have? And instead of wringing my hands and say, like Dorothea Freda, that he doesn't tell us what soul is, and I guess maybe he doesn't, when I read Aristotle's Metaphysics, especially that first book, and I was thinking about the role of number that, and especially three plays in the final proof, I was thinking that soul is something akin to number, something like that, but as far as this single characterizing characteristic. This is my own account in order to make it work. And maybe it doesn't work, but that was how I could make sense of that final argument. So that was my motivation.
It didn't mean to say that it doesn't work. I just thought, I was just wondering how you flesh out some other aspects that are in there, but that Lloyd made.
Yeah, they're not in there. But Proclus, I think, in his commentary on Euclid's geometry, helps a little bit, I think.
Bene, abbiamo il tempo solo per un'altra domanda.
Thank you so much. I just wanted to ask a bit about whether it's fair to identify partlessness and the partlessness of being with any internal differentiation whatsoever. One of the consequences that has is that the forms that he discusses in the final argument are absolutely ultimate and not explainable relative to higher forms in which they participate. So that would have the consequence, it seems to me, that odd and even mm-hmm. could not be explained as participating in number, a form of number, or that they're, because that would include an internal differentiation which would make them partless. The other consequence, it seems to me, that would follow from it is, how do these forms, how could they be the springs towards anything else if they weren't mutually implied at all in one another? You know, how could you move beyond odd and even to anything else if there weren't some relation through which dialectic could move upwards? So those are my two questions about your view.
Okay, well then I must not have been clear in my paper, and I'm sorry about that. Numbers participate in forms, it's not the other way around. So I don't think that the numbers are forms, and I know that there are people in this audience who will disagree with me. That's fine. As far as odd and even, I think that that's how numbers are generated, that they are generated through participating in the odd or the even the same and the difference and being, right, thinking in the later dialogue.
È il turno del professor Noburu Notomi, che parlerà dell'anima e delle idee nel Fedone. Il professor Notomi è professore all'Università di Tokyo, in Giappone, e ha studiato anche alla facoltà di Classics all'Università di Cambridge, dove ha avuto un dottorato nel 1995 con supervisore Giovanni. Poi è stato nelle università di Kyushu e di Keio, è stato come visiting professor all'Università di Utrecht in Olanda e dall'aprile di quest'anno insegna all'Università di Tokyo. È stato presidente della International Plato Society e ha organizzato perciò il nono simposio platonico a Tokyo. Ha pubblicato L'unità del sofista platonico tra il sofista e il filosofo, Cambridge, ha editato insieme a Wilson gli atti del convegno sulla Politeia di Platone ed ha un notevole numero di libri e di articoli sulla filosofia antica in giapponese ed in inglese. I suoi campi sono la prima filosofia greca, i sofisti, Platone, Aristotele e la recezione della filosofia greca nella Asia dell'Est. Prego, professore.
Thank you very much. Basically, I read the paper, but I skip some parts if you look at the electronic text. The sovereign forms in Plato's Phaedo, attention in the Phaedo. This is a central concern in philosophy, why we suppose that we know that what this is, except about when it comes and fear it. We must be aware of our own ignorance about it. Therefore, when Simmias burst into laughter at Socrates' claim that genuine philosophers are practicing this, he replies that ordinary people are totally unaware of what it really means. Philosophy, by contrast, makes us face death in the aspiration of living well. In this respect, Socrates becomes a model of how to die. The Phaedo depicts the death of Socrates in the spring of 399 BC. This event was so important for Plato that the dialogue with this special dramatic setting is expected to show how he understands the philosophy of his master. He explained it as practice of death. The dialogue is a double project. Plato, on the other hand, tried to reveal the essence of Socrates' philosophy, and on the other, forward his own philosophy in order to demonstrate how he takes over his master's mission. Hence, to understand the Phaedo is to approach the heart of Plato's philosophy in relation to Socrates. In this paper, I suggest that a key to interpretation is a close connection between the soul and the forms. Yet we must be aware of a certain tension between the two. On the one hand, it is usually assumed that Socrates is one of the first thinkers who emphasized the ethical importance of the soul psyche as a true self. The word has been used for a vague entity before, like a ghost in Homer. Therefore, Aristophanes mocks Socrates in his comedies for the introduction of the new meaning. This historical aspect accords with the main project of the Phaedo. As the traditional subtitle of this dialogue indicates, its main theme is on soul. Socrates converses with his friend on death and the immortality of the soul. On the other hand, the Phaedo is assumed to be one of the main dialogues, possibly the first, that present Plato's own theory of transcendent forms. Aristotle reports in the Metaphysics that Socrates did not separate the transcendent entities as Plato did. If we trust this report, though I take some issue, the theory of forms is exactly where Plato's philosophy departs from Socrates. If one assumes that the two things, the soul and form, are independent and asks us which the main thing is, we will be at a loss. Seeing this tension, we must seek for a unity in order to understand philosophy as practice of death. In this paper, I will clarify the relation between the Socratic soul and the Platonic forms. And I skipped the first half of the second part, in which remind you that, the theory forms are normally regarded as a bizarre doctrine that ignore our reality. And the forms are, since Aristotle, forms are regarded as redundant metaphysics entities, adding necessary and unnecessary to this world. But this criticism is standing firm on the empiricist basis in considering the reality. And on the other hand, it assumes the modern epistemology, take it for granted that the cognitive subject, I, is fixed as a sole viewpoint from which we perceive objects. So I come to the fourth paragraph of the next page. These are two assumptions, empiricist assumption and modern epistemology assumption, together raise a severe criticism of the theory of forms. If the cognitive subject is fixed as self-identical, and if the reality is what we experience in this world, then forms are nothing but abstract objects postulated in vain. They are deemed redundant, and the theory turns out to erroneous. Seen from this empiricist and modern epistemological viewpoint, Plato's dualism is simply doubling the realities. But is this correct? What is missing in modern epistemology is a possibility of change or transformation of I. In accordance with different experience, we ourselves may change, and in accordance with different cognitive states, the world may also change. I argue that this is exactly what the Phaedo tries to show. Before repudiating the transcendent entities, we should consider the possibility of transformation of ourselves. If the subject I changes or is transformed through experiences, the dualism or two world theory of Plato's metaphysics may make good sense. The two worlds, the sensible and the intelligible, should correspond to the two cognitive stages of experience. The former is cognized by the embodied soul, and the latter by the purified soul. Then we can understand the theory forms as a basis for our experience of transcendence, the double sense of separation. To understand the forms in the Phaedo, we must examine separation, chorismos of intelligible things from sensible things. Aristotle, in Metaphysic Mirror, sees the starting point of Plato's original philosophy in separating the universals. But in Plato's dialogues, the word separation, chorismos, is not used in the context of discussing the forms, except that the adverb, apart, choris, appears in the criticism of the theory in the first part of the Parmenides. Nevertheless, the phrase itself by itself, auto kata auto, expressing the ontological status of forms, signifies, I think, separation. So I think Aristotle's report that the concept of separation has established the theory of forms is basically correct. Separation is an essential factor of the theory. The forms are separated from many changing and conflicting states of affairs. We encounter in this world such conflicting appearances. that something is both just and unjust and beautiful and ugly. But if we stand away from these conflicting states, we will realize the absolute being of justice itself, or beautiful, the beautiful self, as separated from them. The form of the beautiful, for example, is beautiful itself by itself. Hence, separation is twofold. It is separated from many beautiful things on the one hand, and from the other forms, such as ugliness and justice, on the other. Each form exists by itself and is different from the others. We remember that this separation is the focus of Aristotle's criticism exactly because he believed that it produced extra numbers of entities. Here, one crucial side of separation is neglected. When Plato introduced the theory of forms in the Phaedo, the world apart, choris and separation, chorismos, are used in another way. Socrates explained philosophy as a practice of death, namely to separate the soul from the body as much as possible. Death is defined in terms of separation in 64c, which is a famous passage, the definition of death. Later, the very word separation, chorismos, is used twice in the sense of a release of the soul from the body. Moreover, Socrates said that the philosopher does not concern himself with the body, but so far as he can separate himself from it and concentrate upon the soul, 64e. This separation enables the soul to reach the higher cognitive state called wisdom, phronesis, concerning the forms, and 66d2e. In this way, separation characterizes the soul in the Phaedo, while the same word also characterizes the transcendent forms. The double use of separation connects the two sets of items in the following way, namely, what is the separated object to what is separated from, is forms to sensible and soul to body. This double use of the word separation for the soul and the form reveals a core of Plato's philosophy. In trying to prove the immortality of the soul in the Phaedo, Socrates repeatedly demonstrates a pair of theses, namely that the soul exists in itself, separated from the body, and that forms exist themselves in themselves, separated from the sensible. In the concluding remark, the recollection argument, for instance, he clarified this joint proof in 76e. I do not read that text. Here, they agree that the prenatal existence of the soul and the independent existence of the forms have an equal necessity, issa ananke, for they are in similar states. In other words, the soul's being alone by itself and the forms being themselves by themselves stand or fall together. They are correlative. Purification of the soul. This correlativity becomes a focus in the subsequent affinity argument. First, the soul, which is invisible, is proved to resemble the unchanging forms, which, while the body, visible, is more like changing things. Since simple and unchanging things are free from decomposition, we do not have to worry about any destruction of the soul. Then Socrates argued that the soul is dragged and confused by the body, while the soul, when it is separated from the body to be alone by itself, can observe the forms. The process of separation is called purification, katharmos or katharsis. On the other hand, the forms themselves are known when they are separated from conflicting appearances of sensible objects in this world. The correlative states between the intellect and the forms is wisdom. However, the affinity argument is often deemed too weak as a proof of the immortality of the soul. For commentators suggest that the mere resemblance of the soul to the unchanging beings does not guarantee its incorruptibility. We should better expect another purpose of this argument. Concluding that the soul does not vanish after death, Socrates describes two types of the soul after death. On the one hand, the soul that engaged in philosophy and practiced separation during life will leave this world to spend a happy time in the invisible divine region, since it is released from human evils such as folly and wild desires. On the other hand, the soul that departs from the body in a polluted and impure condition sticks to bodily things even after death, unpurified dead souls are portrayed as phantoms which roam around graves. This repeated in the beginning of the myths later. This story shows us another aspect of death. This is once defined as separation of soul and body, but it is now suggested that even after physical death, namely simple separation from the body, a soul can accompany bodily elements with him. One must separate the soul from the body and bodily things as much as possible, even after death. Therefore, practice of death may not end in physical death. Rather, philosophers always care to reach the ultimate state of purification. The soul should be directed from visible things to be divine, to the divine, which is akin to itself. This purification process must be the main message of the affinity argument from the immortality of the soul. Philosophy as care for the soul means release and purification, and the soul without philosophy remains chained with the body through desire and pleasures. Socrates gives the following concluding observation in the philosophy of soul, 84a2b, and which I do not read, but this is the conclusion of that part. Thus, the affinity argument provides an ethical explanation of practice of death as philosophic purification. Next, process of transcendence. Purification that consists of two separations of the soul from the body and of the forms from sensibles make a special experience. I put the diagram in the paper if you can look at. And in the diagram, our initial state is at the bottom. The embodied soul of our an ordinary state is perceived, the sensible things, which both are and are not so and so. Then as the soul becomes aware of something beyond these, it's separated or purified, it is eventually becomes a true soul, that is the intellect. Then it observes and knows purely the forms, which always are, that is separated from sensible things, the forms themselves. So this shift from bottom to the upper stage is a double change of subject and reality. We may call this experience transcendence in the traditional philosophical vocabulary. The theory of forms indicate not only the transcendence of the object, but also transcending experience of the subject, namely ourselves. Therefore, although the forms may appear to be unnecessary and a mistake to the embodied soul in this corporeal world, once it gets separated, the intelligible world of forms is revealed as its proper object. In other words, at the lower stage, we live everyday life with the body, senses and opinions, docile, but we can proceed to the higher stage when where we contemplate the forms with knowledge and wisdom. As for separation, the verb separate, to separate, chorizein, is transitive and requires the active subject. While Aristotle criticized Plato or Platonists for having separated, Plato argues that we, philosophers, should separate the soul as much from the body as possible. Separation is correspondingly the philosophical pursuit of our soul's revelation of the reality. The dynamic combination between the transformation of the soul and the revelation or transfiguration of the reality constitute our transcending experience. Transcendence occurs in two correlative sides. As our soul is purified and getting separated from the body as much as possible during life, the true reality, namely forms, reveal itself in corresponding to our cognition. The separation can only be achieved by full engagement in philosophy during life. Transcendence as transformation of the subject is a response to what Socrates proposed as care for the soul, epimeleia tespuskes, in the Apology. Since it means to convert from the bodily concerns to a true self, this corresponds to practice of death in the Phaedo, which signifies the same conversion of the soul from various earthly things, such as property, honor, appearance, desire, and body, to the true self. Moreover, the conversion of the soul is fully discussed in the educational program of Republic Book 8. In the transcendence, the transformation of a soul into its original form, namely intellect, makes a complete change of views on reality. When the soul is awakened, the world looks totally different, and only then the sensible experience seems like a dream. Accordingly, the dualism of Plato's metaphysics turned out to be a dynamic process of going up to see the forms and then coming back to the ordinary world. However, in the Phaedo, the final argument of the immortality of the soul based on the hypothesis of forms no longer resort to the parallelism of the soul and forms, nor the cognitive relation between the former subject and the latter object. Instead, the ontological status of the soul is discussed in the field of transcendent forms. The soul turned out to have an essential relation to life, so that it does not accept death in any way. It is often pointed out that individual souls are not at issue in the final proof, unlike the earlier proofs. This shift of focus might indicate a further stage after purification. Now the soul looks like a form, or rather it overlaps with the realm of the forms. 6 centuries later, Plotinus reformulated this idea to believe that the intellect, nous, is identical with the forms. The final, the Phaedo as practicing philosophy. If this interpretation is correct, the theory of transcendent forms is not just a doctrine about metaphysical entities, but a practice of our soul becoming the true self, as in death. The contemplation or wisdom of the transcendent reality of forms, in particular, those of important values, good, beauty, and justice, is at once the ground for our living well and the aim of philosophy. To do philosophy is to realize our true self by going beyond our ordinary experiences. Thus, Plato's central message of the Phaedo is that Socrates is a philosopher who practices this purification in life and death. The conversation of death on his last day clearly demonstrates this truth. Finally, the discourse, logos of the Phaedo invites us, the readers, to this philosophy and changes our views. Therefore, reading this dialogue is a practice of care for the soul and practice of death for us as well as for Socrates and Plato. Thank you.
It seems to me that the reason that Socrates says to Callicles that you are my bosinos, and I know that if I can get you to agree with me, then I know that my soul is intuitive the truth, is because Callicles is actually Aristocles, the son of Ariston, before he met Socrates. In other words, that he's a pre-Platonic Plato, that he's giving his self-portrait as Callicles. And that the important question in the Gorgias then is, could Callicles have changed his mind? We know he hasn't changed his mind in the dialogue, so I'm asking you, Noburu, do you think it was possible that the character Callicles in the Gorgias could have changed his mind and transformed in accordance with what you were talking about in this paper? Could he have done so?
Well, the Gorgias is a kind of a prestige of, I think, the Phaedo. What kind of things is needed for Callicles is the Phaedo, the theme of Phaedo is more like this. So I think, well, of course, within the dialogue, Gorgias, you know, Callicles didn't change, it seems. But after it, Plato suggesting some possibility of the character or, you know, personality or the soul may change. But that depends on us, readers. So, you know, so we can change, or we can imagine Callicles change or not. Well, I'm not quite sure whether real Callicles change or not.
Brilliant answer. Thank you.
Could you try to explain in a non-metaphorical way why philosophy is catharsis?
No metaphorical way. Well,
how is it a purification?
Okay. Yes. Well, basically, I think that catharsis is not metaphor. Well, as a Platonist, Plato. Soul is invisible, so I cannot picture it. But the soul itself really becomes get rid of the bodily things. So that's purification. Is I think that Plato is not meant.
How does philosophy get rid of the body? I'm just using your language.
Yes.
How does philosophy get rid of the body?
Two way of explanation. One is get rid of things, removing things. The other is conversion. You know, the looking the other side. So I think that those two explanation should be put together. So not just you know putting dirty things out, but we have to shift to a change of the direction as the book 7 of the Republic. So that's I think I try to put these two together.
Many people in antiquity would speak about conversion.
Yes, yes.
And would deny that that involves catharsis from the body.
I see.
Including the Stoics, for example.
Yeah. Yes, I see. It's difficult. Okay, yes.
So why is it? Why is it a catharsis from the body?
I think that's probably Plato believed, believes that the sensible things, the changing things, and the opposite is idiom, eternal, unchanging things. That's, the intellect should be correlated to the unchanging things. That's why the antwa, the bodily things. I repeated the claims. Thank you very much.
I have a much more specific question,
yeah,
which is that in 81 B to C, he discusses the souls which are separated from the bodies but which are impure. And he says that they're separated and asks whether they're auto kathauto. And the answer is clearly not. So there it looks like being separate and being auto kathauto are different from one another. So,
I see.
The thought is that these are different claims that are being made. And so I was wondering what you thought of that.
Well, of course, auto kathauto is a kind of state of the complete separateness. But separation is a maybe a some kind of process and this allow some degrees, you know, as purification. You know, purification is not all or nothing. You know, it's a kind of process in the middle, half purified, or that kind of. So separation can be I think that separation, the word separation, can be used in that. Process
it could be used in a progressive sense, but it also has been separated.
Yes.
So is it purified after it has been separated? So now we no longer have a process. The process is done, and there's still a question as to whether it's out to cut out or not. And it looks like precisely that's what leads to the souls reincarnating, is that they're not out to cut out. So somehow that's what pulls them back into the body.
Yes, I should check the text and check whether I fit my.
Ultima domanda, Gonzales.
Thank you, Noburu. I just want to actually follow up on the same question, but from a different angle. Because if, as you claim, the separation of the soul and the separation of the forms go together or fall together, I forget how you put it, but the two go together, isn't it at least strange that Plato, while using the choris chorismos language repeatedly of the soul's separation, should consistently avoid that language in speaking of the forms? I mean, it's at least strange. Do you have any, the parallel that you're making would be even, Plato could make it even all the stronger if he were to use the chorus chorismos language of the forms, because then we have a perfect parallel. The forms are, you know, are chorus, the soul is chorus, the forms are chorus. So why should he, so the fact that he seems to, not seems to, the fact that he consistently avoids the chorismos language in relation to the forms, would suggest that he is making some kind of distinction between being auto katauton and being chorismos.
Wow, thank you. That's it's not easy for me to explain why, but I think that more emphasis is on the separation of the soul for Plato. So, well, Aristotle, of course, you know, explained in terms of cosmos, but I think Plato, I think Plato wanted to explain the separation of the soul. Then the separation of the form is a kind of, that is what I can say. Yeah, Plato's emphasis is more the separation of the soul from the body than forms. That's one. Sorry, well, yeah, it's true, Plato did not use the vocabulary.
Grazie. Comunicazione di oggi è di Renato Brandão sulla traduzione e significato di Fedone 74 di 79. Brandão è dottore in filosofia alla PUC, alla Pontificia Università Cattolica di Rio de Janeiro, con una tesi sull'ontologia di Platone che sta per essere pubblicata. È stato visiting student alla Brown University e ha sviluppato una ricerca di postdottorato sul Parmenide di Platone presso la cattedra Arcai UNESCO di Brasilia e è in attesa di essere nominato professore assistente alla PUC di Rio. La parola per andare.
Grazie. No, sorry.
Dopo questo
usavo
show.
Ah, sì.
First of all, I would like to thank you all, and I would like to say that it's a great pleasure to be here. I hope you are all enjoying Brazil and the conference. And I'm going to be very briefly. My point is not a sophisticated point at all. That's enough. The concept of separation plays a large role in Plato's scholarship since the very beginning of this tradition, when Aristotle first decided to comment his master's work. Aristotle takes separation as a central feature of Plato's ontology and spent most part of his time dedicated to Plato on the metaphysics, criticizing the single attribute of the forms. Surprisingly, Plato himself almost never used the term to describe the forms or the relationship between forms and particulars, the only exception being the opening moments of Socrates' discussion with Parmenides in the dialogue named after the great Eleatic philosopher. As we could expect, Plato's silence on the issue of separation made some scholars think that separation was not an important feature of his ontology after all, or even that it was not one of his metaphysical claims. However, since Aristotle, for many different reasons, is in a very privileged position on the issue of how to understand Plato's philosophy, I take it for granted that the concept of separation has a central function on Plato's theory of reality. What I do not take for granted is that we should understand Plato's concept of separation based on Aristotle's criticism of it. So in my presentation, I will look for ways to understand separation in Plato regardless of what Aristotle says of it, especially regardless of the technicalities Aristotle brings to the discussion. At this moment, I'm sure you expect me to deliver a talk about the Phaedo's passage on the separated soul and to establish analogies between forms and souls in one hand and things and body on the other hand, and I would never be able to do that job after Professor Noburu. But that's not what I'm going to do. What I'm going to do is to analyze a single sentence of the Phaedo in which Socrates explicitly talks about the difference between forms and things. My hope is that a correct appreciation of this single sentence will help to clarify the meaning of separation. The sentence under consideration has been for a long time a source of disputes, both among translators and philosophers. And its interpretation depends on a series of judgments about Greek syntax. Its context is one of great importance since it happens to be located among the famous statements of Socrates' theory of recollection. In this part of his argument, Socrates makes the very straightforward claim that equal sticks or stones are inevitably also unequal, since, on the other hand, the equal itself cannot betray any measure of inequality. The particular sticks and stones and the equal itself are not the same. The former can, however, remind the soul of the living, which the soul must have contemplated before incarnation. Therefore, the argument seems to go, the human soul is immortal. The difficulties begin when we try to understand in what sense the equal sticks and stones are also unequal, and on the other hand, in what sense the equal itself cannot be unequal. There seem to be several options of reading, each one with its pros and cons. The Greek text for the passage is the following. In the slide, I just took off the interrogative part, the question marks. Ara u litoi men nisoi, kai kisila iniote, tauta onta, tome nisa finitai, todeu. In order to understand the correct meaning of this sentence, we must first deal with the fact that the verb finomai has two distinct uses. If it is followed by an infinitive, its meaning is appear to be or seem to be with the possible addition but are not. On the other hand, if it is followed by a participle, it means seems to be or observed to be with the possible addition and really are. Since the text does not provide either one of the complements, the interpreter must decide for himself which sense Plato intended to convey. And of course, there are philosophical consequences attached to that choice. For some interpreters, the mere fact that sensible particulars can generate contrary perception is sufficient to differentiate them from the forms, even if they are not in themselves contradictory entities. This line of interpretation reads finite as followed by an elided infinitive, as was advocated, for instance, by Arshan Hind, for whom the existence of a conflict of opinion is sufficient to establish the difference between particulars and the ideas. Others, however, maintain that Socrates would need more in order to distinguish forms and particulars, especially in face of Socrates' further claim that equal sticks and stones are in themselves somehow deficient when compared with the equal itself. For those, therefore, Socrates would need to talk about the actual properties of forms and things and not about how these things appear to be. But for that claim to be made, Plato would need an enlightened participle after finite time. Another point of dispute is the correct understanding of the pronouns tomen, in the expression tomen, todeu. These words offer an even wider range of possible reading. First of all, there's a line of manuscript in which these words are replaced by totemen, totedeu, which would give the translation sometimes sticks and stones, while being the same, at one time appear equal, at another time not. On this reading, Socrates' point is that a pair of equal sticks, while remaining the same sticks, are at one time equal and at another time unequal, because they have changed. And this contrasts with the form of equality, which never changes. Although there is a respectable manuscript tradition for this reading of the Greek text, it must be noted that this replacement would make the use of eniote in the sentence a little awkward. Besides, stones are certainly not the best sensible entity to illustrate changes over time. No doubt stones actually change over time, but they certainly are not the most natural example to make the point that sensible things change while form do not. On the other hand, if you choose to adopt the manuscript tradition that reads Tomen Todeu instead of Totemen Totedeu, things aren't really better. For we can attribute three very different meanings to the sentence according to the gender we assign to the pronouns. The pronouns can be masculine, and in this case, the sentence would be translated as sometimes sticks and stones, while being the same, seem equal to one person but not to another person. A pair of sticks one meter long, for instance, seem equal to one observer and unequal to another. On initial consideration, this interpretation appears to be satisfactory, mostly because it offers a natural translation of the Greek. However, on conceptual ground, it seems problematic. Could it not be the case that the judgment of one of the two people is just wrong? Besides, why would Socrates explain the ontological difference between forms and sensible particulars solely on the ground that one is capable of misapprehend sensible objects, but not forms? Again, many critics emphasize that Socrates would rather make a point about these things in themselves and not about the human apprehension of them. Another option is to consider the pronouns as neutral and to render the sentence as sometimes sticks and stones, while being the same, seem equal to one thing but not to another thing. In this case, we wouldn't be talking about a pair of sticks or stones. Socrates' point would rather be that a given stick 1 meter long is equal to another one of the same size, but unequal to a third stick half a meter long, for instance. This reading has the advantage of resulting in an evidently true statement, since it seems to be equal is a relation between two things, and to change the second member of the relation will eventually lead to the case where the two things are not equal. The problem of this reading is that it would make no sense of aeniote again. A stick or stone will always be equal to something and unequal to another thing. So why would Socrates say that this scenario would happen only sometimes in aeniote? A third possibility is to read the pronouns again as neutral, but this time conferring to them an adverbial force. In this case, we should translate the sentence as sometimes sticks and stones, while being the same, seem equal in one respect but not in another respect. The point would be that a given pair of sticks can be equal in size while being unequal in, say, thickness. This adverbial reading has the advantage of leaving unspecified the aspects in which the sticks and stones are equal or unequal. As a result, it implicitly includes all the other possibilities mentioned before. Its downside, however, is that it's not usual at all to have a neutral pronoun acting as an adverb. As remarked by Bostock, one could certainly expect the feminine pronoun in an adverbial construction like this. Although commentators have engaged in a long debate about which one of the above-mentioned options is the one that better conveys Plato's intentions, I think that we should consider the possibility that Plato is actually leaving the text open for these different readings. In this scenario, Plato would have chosen a deliberate vague form of writing in order to state the fact that sensible objects are contradictory in many different ways, all of them expressed by the opposition of relative pronouns. This possibility becomes more likely when we compare these lines of the Phaedo with a passage of the Symposium 2.11.8.2.5. In this Symposium passage, Diotima tries to explain to Socrates the difference between the beauty itself and the other beautiful things. First, then, it is always, neither come to be nor passing away, neither increasing nor diminishing. Next, it's not beautiful in one respect and ugly in another respect. temen kalon tedeaskon. Not beautiful at one time and not at another. Totemen totedeum. Not beautiful compared with one thing and ugly compared with another. Pros mento kalon pros delto toeskron. Not beautiful in one place and ugly in another, as to be beautiful to some and ugly to others. Enta men kalon, enta de askron, hos tisi men on kalon, tisi de askron. As you can see, the three possible readings for the ambiguous pronouns of the Phaedo sentence, plus the version with the adverb of time totted that we dismissed on textual grounds, are here laid out by Diotima as different ways in which a beautiful thing can be ugly. Well, the same goes for equal sticks and stones. There are various ways in which sensible equals are also unequal, and each one of these ways represent a possible reading for the indefinite pronouns we find at the line 74b7. In the Phaedo, Plato's use of the pronouns is intentionally indeterminate in order to express in just one sentence the many different ways in which the sensible objects can display their indeterminacy. Well, at the beginning of this presentation, I promised that this single sentence of the Phaedo could clarify our understanding of Plato's concept of separation. Here's how I think that can be done. Plato's use of the indefinite pronouns in the oppositional construction, tamen todeu, represents an ingenious device to express the various relations that every sensible object holds with other things. These relations are constitutive of the sensible objects, and they determine what property these objects actually have. In fact, the sensible objects are involved in so many relations that for each property they have, there will be another relation in which they display the exact contrary property. That's why Plato always used the pronouns together with the particles men and the in oppositional construction. The forms, on the other hand, do not hold any kind of relation to other things, and that's why they are not described by relative pronouns in oppositional construction, but by the intensive pronoun autos. The contrast between the expression tomen todeu, used to describe the sensible things, and the expression autokatoto, used to describe the forms, represents, therefore, a syntactical device designed to express the distinction between a relational kind of object and a non-relational isolated kind of entity. Forms have their properties by themselves, in the sense that their lack of relation with other things makes them perfect and independent unities, described only by their self-predication. On the other hand, sensible things have their properties in relation to other things, which make them subject of opposite predication and unstable entities. Now, if we assume that Vlasov's thesis, according to which the expression enai horis and enai autokatoto represent both the same metaphysical claim, we can conclude that to be separate means nothing more than to be isolated, which is actually the ordinary meaning of this word. So my point is that we do not need to understand separation as a technical term formulated to express complex philosophical claims such as ontological priority, ontological independence, or even ontological transcendence in Plato. The distinction between non-relational and relational entities is at the core of Plato's metaphysics, and to say that the forms are separated is equivalent to state this very distinction. To be separated is to be set apart, disconnected from everything else, isolated, but nothing more than that. Thank you.
Grazie, Brandão. Domande, prego.
Renato, after a wonderfully doctrinally platonic paper from Noburu, yours was so pedagogically delightfully platonic that thing you did was stone on that editorial problem, but that's killer. Now, but there's a deeply platonic joke in this whole presentation, because you take this sentence and of course the most controversial sense is the next one, is the one about Alta Taisa.
Yes.
So since you were listening carefully to Sophia's paper, and since Alta Taisa is historically the best evidence of the existence of intermediates in the Phaedo, I'd like to pin you down a little bit on 74C1 and ask you how you think about the relationship between the phrase Alta Taisa in relation to He is Botes and Pa Izon. Which do you feel is the best term for equality in Plato's Phaedo? Which of the three, please, sir?
Okay. Well, I think that the Alta Taisa represent intermediates in the sense that they are immanent properties. And for me, Plato needs immanent properties just because forms in themselves cannot have relation with anything else. So the intermediates are the they play the role of something that in a way remind us of the forms, and in a not specified way, and I mean not specified by Plato, represents the casual power of forms on things, on particulars, so that Plato does not need to say that the forms, these perfect units, separate units, are in the particulars or related to the particulars in any way. So, in my opinion, he just created that category of intermediates to solve the problem of how a separate entity can actually have causal power over the plurality of objects. I'm not sure if it was.
Thank you very much. I want to query your suggestion that he's left the choice open between, I take it, the four readings. Now, that, it doesn't seem to me at present to be possible that he could have left it open, the choice open between the four readings. But first of all, either he wrote Tomen or he wrote Totemen, but he didn't write both.
Yeah, sure.
Because he wrote Totemen, then your argument disappears. So he must, for you to be right, he must have written Tomen. He can't have intended the last meaning because it doesn't, that is, in one respect, another respect, because that usage doesn't exist. So you're left with just two meanings, either tomen, you've got tomen, todehu, either that dative is to be constructed with finite, or it's to be constructed with issa. So I think your ambiguity will just be reduced to those two. If Plato intended even that ambiguity, what do you think Simias meant when he answered enthusiastically, absolutely so, paniomenu? Is Simias just being very stupid to say yes?
He would not be the only one in Plato's dialogue to answer yes without understanding the full meaning of Socrates' words. But in relation to the point that the adverbial reading is not possible, I certainly do not know the Greek enough to discuss that with you. But I took it from who is the one?
Gallup, maybe from Gallup.
Yeah, Gallup mentioned it, but that he's not the advocate of it.
You meant,
okay, sorry.
Well, I hope it doesn't have any advocates. No,
but there is. I can actually verify it and
okay. Thank you.
Just one question. When Aristotle did say that Plato separates ideas and calls them ideas in distinction to Socrates, to which dialogue does he rather refer? To the Phaedo or to the Symposium? Because the introduction of ideas is completely different in the Phaedo and in the Symposium. The Symposium, the ideas are seen, they are a revelation, And in the Phaedo, there are hypotheses.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, I think that despite the difference of presentation, we can find a coherent theory of idea on the middle in the middle dialogues and the first part of the Parmenides. And the fact that the first part of the Parmenides is very effective on the issue of separation seems to me to point to the fact that even if Plato does not use that word often, the concept of separation is important on Plato's metaphysics. So I think we can I would say both. Aristotle is based on both, and probably on oral teachers.
I'd like to ask a question about why, press you a little bit on your rejection of the possibility that the epistemic properties of the entities may not be enough to distinguish them. So the fact that, just point out one thing, it is interesting, at the very beginning of the recollection argument, the whole point is you recollect something of which the knowledge is different. This is always a strange expression that suggests that the epistemic features of, yes. of the objects are important. And one might think, just to appeal to Aristotle, there are some things about which you cannot be wrong. You either understand them or you don't, either got them or you don't. It may well be that equality is like that. You either equality of form is appearing to you or it's not. It never appears. If it appears unequal, it's not appearing to you. Right? And so you might say that is a very important distinction, and it's an epistemic one, and it might be might be the one that's relevant.
Yeah, I actually think it's relevant and important, and I think it is under consideration in this passage, and that's one of the reasons why Plato leaves it open to different readings. One of them is the possibility that the verb finalmai is actually followed by a elided infinitive.
Two related questions on these questions, the indeterminacy of translation. I'm wondering, with the proper attention to context, it's not quite so indeterminate. First of all, with finitai, in the immediately previous sentence, which is also a question, he says, soy finitai. And it's a question of appears to you. If it doesn't appear to you, do you think so? And so I think it's natural to read the next question also as with an implied soy. Is it doesn't appear to you that something is already equal sometimes? So this might be, it might be a little bit less indeterminate.
Yeah,
and the second part about the toe, I think I'd have to take exactly the opposite of the previous question. I think the adverbial construction is very much possible. And in fact, given the, at least the way it's marked in the text, the circumflex accent, which means it can be an indefinite pronoun, it can stand for T, to someone or something. So I think, at least the way it's in our modern text, the way it's, the accent that we have, has to be interpretation, and therefore again, well, and you've shown that of course that means with this parallel supposing passage that these other you could have said it in a different way, but I think at least in the text we have it has to be interpreted. But you just want to
the problem with the adverbial option is that, as I remarked, Boston, very eagerly says that we would expect a feminine pronoun to the adverbial construction and not a neutral or masculine pronoun. And so I think it is one of the possibilities, but it's not the most evident one.
But if it were the indefinite pronoun, there couldn't be a certain. And of course, Plato didn't write in accents, but.
So, it's a modern edition.
Yeah, well, yes, but it would have been pronounced one way or the other, with or without the what he wrote. So.
Yes.
Ultimo intervento.
I was wondering about the problem that you raised for the masculine reading, for taking him as masculine. You said that then it's not clear, it just looks like it's a perspectival problem. But if you take the finitive with the participle, then to one person, it genuinely is manifestly one way, and to another person, it is manifestly a different way. So that didn't seem, didn't seem like you really had that problem. That's only if you take the finitive with the infinitive. And I do think that this also, David Sudley was saying that you only have two indeterminacies. But I wonder if you have four, because even if we take the masculine and the second reading, then we also multiply it by either the infinitive or the participle. So, I think you could take it as masculine, and then it's unclear whether it's apparently so or manifestly so. And I think it's possible that that masculine is in contrast with the soy. Well, does it appear to you this way? Well, consider this. To one person, to another person. So that at least seems like a possible way of reading the flow of the text.
I totally agree.
Grazie a tutti.